sing unto the Lord this morning. Let's go down to the river. There's a man walking on the water. Brother Bob asked me earlier. He said, that's after the first song. I said, yeah, we're having a baptism afterwards. He goes, what? I said, yeah, and you're volunteering to help me. He goes, no. No, we're not having no baptism. Not unless somebody needs to be baptized, we'll go right up to the pond and we'll baptize you. Amen. So let's go down to the river. There's a man walking on the water. Well, let's go down to the river. Oh, there's a man walking on the water.
Yeah.
this morning, and we thank you, dear Lord, for that Holy Ghost fire, dear God. We thank you, dear Lord, for that oil that's been poured upon us. We thank you, dear Lord, for that great price that you paid. And there's no other name this morning. There's no other name, no other name like my Lord. There's no other name more beautiful to me. That's why, dear Lord, I love you this morning. Lord, I praise you this morning. You've been so good to us. We just worship you. Oh, come on, church. Let's worship him this morning. Let's worship the Lord this morning. Amen. No other name like Jesus.
I sing praises. I sing glory to your name.
Oh, he's praise, amen.
Good place to be this morning, amen. One dark night in Egypt, a fearful time had come for one little Hebrew boy who was his father's little firstborn son. With the angel of death, he was passing low, and it was hard to fall asleep. But one little light stood in his mind as he lay there counting sheep. He wondered why this young lad had to die, why his blood was on the door. Through the wind and rain, and it still remained, but he wanted to be sure. So he called out to his earthly father with a trembling voice so scared, crying, "Father, will you please look and see if the Lord is still there?" He said, "Son, now don't you worry, for the blood is there to stay. The winds may blow and the rains may fall, but it won't just wash away.
Just one.
This verse was written by a gentleman. I was blessed to be able to actually meet him and hear his testimony. And I got to sing with him down at the Ryman Auditorium. And a lot of people don't realize the testimony that some of these country music singers have, because they don't always just put it right out there towards any part of their life. But I was blessed the night that Merle Haggard gave his testimony at the Ryman Auditorium. And he wrote this song a long time ago. I mean, it was on vinyl, put it that way, okay? It was on vinyl. Some people are going, why is this vinyl? Yeah, that's the big CD with the little bitty hole in it. You listen to this song and you would swear that it was just written in the last couple of years.
The ancient Roman Empire, its world is due to fall. And it's much too big a thing for mortal man. Just take a look around and see the writing on the wall. Somehow we've got to find a helping hand. Well, this world has never been in the awful shape it's in. People storm the things our leaders do. But this time a prayer was spoken from the heart of every man. Take a hold and lead us through. The roaring of fire is now a local sound. Our city streets are filled with acronyms. And law is now a mockery throughout our troubled land. Destruction seems to be the current trend. Well, this world has never been in the awful shape it's in. Our leaders seem in doubt of what to do. Well, this time a prayer was spoken from the heart of every man.
Closer, we got some of these big TV preachers, you know, they're trying to get us to look at what's going on, trying to figure out when Jesus is coming back. I put a post on Facebook the other day. I said, I don't care what any of them have to say about trying to figure out how close we are to him coming back. I know we're close. I'm just going to keep doing his work till he comes. I ain't got time to worry about the mathematics of the Bible and trying to figure this out and that out and this out. You know, all that's great. That's great, but to me, that's worldly knowledge that I don't need. Because I can sit and figure out and say, okay, I've got it figured down to, it's going to be this time. My Bible says, no man save God himself knows when he's coming back. That means I can't figure it to within 24 hours. I can't figure it to within a week. I can't figure it down to a month or even a year. Because if I could, then God's a liar. And if you want to call God a liar, let me know so I can get about a half a block away from you so when the meteor hits you in the head. Amen. We got to make sure that we're running with the right folks. Not with people that are concerned about when he's coming back, but just have assurance that we know he's coming back. Amen. So you listen to this here song. This is a good one. This was kind of an upbeat song. It's called Running with the Glory Crowd.
Amen. Well, perilous times are surely here.
Your hearts are cold and filled with fear. Things we've stood for so long are now rejected and branded as wrong. Still shines and the truth still rings and the Bible still rides and God still reigns. Heaven's still waiting up above the cloud for the grand arrival of the glory crowd.
Amen.
Well, I'm gonna run with the glory crowd, the blood-bought church John talked about, anchored in the rock, taking my stand, holding in the nails God hang. Well, I'm held in contempt and I'm viewed with scorn, 'cause I'm out of step and I won't be poor. But I'm marching to a heavenly drum beat now. Since I started running with the glory crowd. Amen.
Now the Bible says in the latter days, coming a time of falling away.
Love will fade and faith will dim. Sin will rule the hearts of men. Oh, my folks have stopped and turned aside. There's a glorious church that won't break stride. Marching straight, singing loud. Oh, there's no stopping God's glory crowd.
Amen.
Well, I'm gonna run with the glory crowd, the blood-bought church I'm talking about. Anchored in the rock, taking my stand, clinging to the nails God hate. Well, I'm held in contempt and abused with scorn, 'cause I'm out of step and I won't conform. But I'm marching to a heavenly drum beat now. Since I started running with the glory
crowd. I started running with the glory crowd.
I started running with the glory crowd.
Are you running with the glory crowd? Amen. Amen. Give the Lord a hand of praise.
Will give me oil in my lamp, keep me burning.
Give me all in my name, I pray.
Will give me all in my name.
Word of God, and you prepare yourself all week. You're ready to go?
And then
Saturday afternoon, that evening, God changes it. You think He changes it, and you go, I'm not feeling anything out of this one, God. And you go somewhere else, and you get up early this morning, and He done changed it again. So, you know, you got to be ready, instant in season and out, and be ready for what the Lord has for you. So I'm going to try to help you this morning and do some teaching on the sin nature and the license that that people think they have to sin. And not only that, but the struggle within ourselves. If you got your Bibles this morning, turn with me, if you would, into Romans chapter 6. Very familiar passage. I want to read verses 1 and 2. This is where I want to take my text from this morning. Lord help us. Romans chapter 6, verses 1 and 2. Stand with me if you would for the reading of God's Word. The Apostle Paul is writing here, and he says, "What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein?" Heavenly Father, I ask you one more time, Lord, help me to rightly divide your word that I felt this morning, dear Lord, that you gave to me to give to them. And God, I ask you to help us to understand the sin nature. Understand, dear Lord, that we don't have the license. Lord, to understand that there is a struggle that goes on within us. Help us this morning, and we'll give you the praise, we'll give you glory. And everybody said amen. Amen. And amen. You may be seated this morning. There are some people who do not know. I said there are some Christians who do know. Let me back up here. There's a lot of Christians who do know that the believer has a sin nature. And there's a lot of people today that don't believe that we have a sin nature. Because of that, they use such an excuse to sin and keep sinning. In other words, they say, "I have a sin nature, so I can't help but sin." Now, let me prove to you this morning that you have a sin nature. This little girl has a sin nature. And when she gets about 2 years old, maybe not that old, look at everybody. Say hi. You're on camera. Say hi. She has a sin nature inside of her right now. Yeah, take her bottle away from her, she gets mad. But when she gets a little older, and you put another little child in the same crib with her, and put one toy in there, little Amora is going to say, "You have it. You play with it." No, that sin nature is going to rise up in those little children. Come on. And they're going to fight and argue and scream and cry and pull at that toy. Because that toy is theirs. Huh? This little child, when she was born, with a sin nature. When you were born, with a sin nature. Come on. Most fall back to the verse that Paul wrote in Romans 7 and 15. For that which I do, I allow not.
Yeah.
For what I would, that do I not. But what I hate, that do I. So many Christians today have the sin nature, but they have an excuse why they're not living right with God. And they take that scripture out of context. They also fall back onto another statement made by Paul in Romans 5 and 20, which says, moreover, the law entered that the offense might be abound, but where sin abound, grace did much more abound. They want to use excuses for sinning.
Yeah.
Come on now, I'm going to help you and I. They argue that inasmuch as grace is more powerful than sin, why worry about sin? Hello? As stated, they use the sin nature as a license to sin. Paul addressed the mindset by asking the question in our text, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? His answer was instant and his answer was blunt. God forbid. How shall we who are dead to sin, come on church, live any longer therein? So, to try to use the fact that one has a sin nature, claiming that one therefore cannot help but sin, to use some street terminology, hogwash.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
Those who think such things, and many do. In the first place, don't know much about the sin nature. In the second place, they don't know anything about the cross. The Lord doesn't save us in sin, but rather from sin.
Amen.
Can I get an amen in here this morning?
Amen.
Now, my question is, those who act upon this and do this, are they saved? I would seriously doubt that such a person is actually saved.
Amen.
That's my opinion.
Amen.
For anyone who truly knows Christ, who has truly accepted Christ as his Savior, the last thing you and I want to do is to sin.
Amen. Amen.
If you accepted him, such a believer has a divine nature in his heart and life, and it's been placed there by the Holy Spirit.
Right.
And sin is abhorrent to it. Such a person is not looking for an excuse to sin, but rather for ways not to sin.
Amen.
Because this is so very, very important, church. And please allow me to say it again. When a person comes to Christ, when you give your heart to the Lord, that person is truly a new creation.
Amen.
And all in Christ Jesus. As such, old things have truly passed away, and all things have become new.
Amen.
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 Amen. I may own the same suit that I had when I was in sin, but I've church, what's on the inside that matters. Amen. I may look the same. I may talk and act the same. Amen. Part my hair the same way. Brother Burley and I, if we had a comb, Brother Tim, we wouldn't part with it. day go tomorrow. Church, what matters is what happens on the inside.
Yes.
Amen. The sin and the gross indulgence he, as an unredeemed individual, once loved, he hates now. Come on. The things he once hated, namely living for God, he now loves.
Amen.
Come on, are you hearing me this morning?
Amen.
When you and I were in sin, we didn't care for God. We didn't care for the things of this world. We didn't care if we went ahead and sinned. We didn't have no love for God. But now since you're saved, you're born again. Amen. I hate the things I do.
Yep.
I used to do. I don't want to do them no more.
Amen.
Come on. The sin nature is still there.
Yep.
How do I know? What if I came up and slapped you on the side of the face? Huh? You're going to say, well, thank you, Pastor. No, you probably ought to turn the other cheek like we should. But no, that old sin nature is going to rise up in you. And you may say, call me a name that you wish you wouldn't have. Huh? Come on, I don't see no halos in here this morning. Sister Sandy's got her hair up on the bun, but that's not her halo. Brother Bob Becker going like this. Are you understanding it? You have this sin nature inside of you. God didn't take that away. But when you got born again, that old sin nature is like an old bear in the wintertime. It's in hibernation. It's been dormant. It should be down. It's down there, but it should not be affecting you at all. But sadly, so many Christians likes to bring it back up. They like that old sin nature to rise up again. You cross me, boy. Huh? We're going to bury the hatchet, but I'm going to leave the handle up about that much. And if you cross me one more time, I'm going to grab that hatchet. Not every Christian is perfect. Huh? That old sin nature inside of us. Come on, church. We got to learn, amen, to turn the other cheek. We got to learn to pray for them that despisely use us. We got to learn to turn them over, amen, to God, amen, and still love them and go for, amen, take them before the Lord.
Amen.
The things he once hated, he now loves. Meaning, the namely, living for God. In fact, the human nature of such a person has changed because he is born again. But unfortunately, most people, even when they come to Christ, are little taught God's prescribed order of victory. So they set out to live for the Lord in all the wrong ways. Now, back to the original subject. If a person wants to sin, that person is not really saved. In respect to this, I got word to back it up. Well, thank you for asking. You got word to back it up, Pastor? Yes, I do. 1 John 3:9, the beloved John said, 1 John 3:9, whosoever is born of God does not commit sin. For his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of God. Now, let me break down that scripture for you. Whosoever is born of God does not commit sin, means does not practice sin. For his seed remains in him. What is the seed? The word of God.
Amen.
Come on. And he cannot sin means cannot continue to practice sin.
That's right.
Because he is what? He is born of God. This refers to a repugnancy of sin in the heart of the true Christian. Amen. Come on, church, when I gave my heart to the Lord, yes, there were still problems. Yes, there's still problems today, but that's where the sanctification comes into play, that God is still working on me. But I don't get up every morning and go, oh, I'm not sinning, I want you to say, I'm not doing this. No, I get up rejoicing in the Lord because I'm in Him and He's in me.
Amen.
Amen. So many people are trying to cross every T and dot every I every day.
Come on.
And before you know it, they've done made a mistake.
Yep.
And they go, oh, I failed God again today. Guess what? We fail Him every day. Huh? John also said in 1 John chapter 3 in verses 5 and 6, he said, and you know that He was manifested to take away our sins.
Yeah.
What do you mean? He did so at the cross.
Yes.
The Christian cannot practice what Christ came to take away and destroy.
Amen.
That's right. Amen.
Amen. Preach it, Pastor Gerald.
Yes.
Come on. He did so at the cross. The Christian cannot practice what Christ came to take away and destroy.
Amen.
He said, in Him is no sin.
Amen.
This presents the fact that He was able to be the perfect sacrifice to take away the sin of the world, which completely destroys the erroneous doctrine Jesus died spiritually, as some claim.
Come on.
Yeah.
Wrong. He did not die spiritually. Verse 6, so whosoever abides in Him sins not. That meaning does not practice sin.
Yes.
Whosoever sins means practices sin, has not seen Him, neither know Him.
Amen. Right.
As stated, Jesus saves from sin, not in sin.
Amen.
If we look to the cross, sin will not have dominion over us.
Amen.
Huh? Now, that's the sin nature we're talking about. So many Christians today are trying to sanctify self. How are they trying to sanctify self? By self. Come on. Most Christians, tragically, although they're saved, simply do not know how to live for God.
Yep.
This means that almost all the ways that are taught boil down to the fact that those ways are wrong. What one ought to be, what one is, in fact, must be, can be brought only about by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
What we need to be, we cannot make of ourselves.
Right, right, right.
Amen. Unfortunately, most of all the teaching and all the preaching on the subject is that self trying to sanctify self.
Yeah.
Turn your TV on, you listen to it. I'm here to bring the champion out of you.
Yeah.
Concerning that, Paul said in Galatians 3 and 3, are you so foolish?
Yeah.
Are you so foolish? Having begun in the Spirit means, do you think that you can now be brought to a state of spiritual maturity by means of self-effort? Yeah. That's what he's saying. Are you not made perfect by the flesh?
Yeah.
These Galatians were practicing salvation by faith and sanctification by self.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of Christians today are the same way.
Yeah.
I can beat this habit. No, you can't.
Come on.
Amen, church. It takes the Holy Ghost to move upon you, to help you, to lead you, to guide you.
Yep. Amen.
I can't do nothing within myself. I need Him to lead me and guide me every day.
Yeah. Yeah. All things through Christ.
But the church world today thinks, and is responsible behind the pulpit, what's being taught,
that you can do it yourself.
Yeah, come on.
No, you can't.
Come on.
Self cannot sanctify self.
Amen.
No matter how religious the efforts may be, as flesh cannot sanctify flesh. This can only be done as stated by the Holy Spirit, who works exclusively within the framework of the finished work of Christ, which requires the believer to evidence faith that exclusively in Christ and the cross. It is always a matter of faith, but it must be faith in the right, correct object, which is ever the cross of Christ. When God gave Sister Angela the symbol for our church years ago, if you will notice, This represents the Holy Ghost, the Word of God, cross of Christ. That Holy Ghost resemblance, symbol, works only within the cross. What am I saying? So many people are trying to work outside of the cross by self, thinking they're going to make it. Go for it. Go for it. Myself, I want the Holy Ghost to lead me. I want Him. He only works when my faith is anchored in the finished work of Christ and what He did on the cross for me, allowing then the Holy Ghost to work upon me. He will not work outside of the cross. That's why they say we don't need to preach on the cross no more. We don't need to preach on the blood no more. We don't need to sing those things no more. Yes, you do.
Amen.
If it wasn't for the cross of Christ, I don't worship that wooden thief. I worship Him who paid a great price on that cross. Then that, by my faith in what He did,
Amen.
Allows the Holy Spirit then to work within my life. As long as I keep my faith in the cross of Christ. In that finished work. So, what am I saying? So many people are taking themselves out of that. And they're trying to do it themselves. And they wonder why they're failing. Because they're allowing the sin nature.
Amen.
To rise back up. And they're trying to do it themselves. Amen. Turn everything over to the Lord. And allow the Holy Spirit to move and work on you. Amen. Well, Pastor, I've been dealing with something for years. Guess what? You're going to deal with it if you keep trying to take care of it. But as soon as you take it, say, Lord, I can't do it no more. It's been about 4 years ago, and I ain't going to say what, but amen, there was a burden on my shoulder. I said it before. I was carrying a load, Brother Bond, and I didn't know how to get rid of it. And I was washing the dishes, and I heard Brother Donnie on the radio saying, you can't take care of yourself. You got to turn it over to God. I've heard that many a different time. Finally, it got down into my soul, and I said, God, I can't carry this more. And He took that burden away from me that moment. That moment when I said, Lord, I surrender. I can't do it no more. And I'm free from that from this day forward. Why? Because the Lord heard my prayer. Amen. Come on, church. He hears your prayer. I prayed for years. Lord, I can't do it. I need your help. Amen. It was still there. But thank God, He took care of it. Amen. So, concerning this, Paul says you're foolish. You can't sanctify. These Galatians were practicing faith. Now, so what are they doing? They're going into a erroneous direction. What do you mean, Pastor? Well, let me tell you. When the preacher, whoever it may be, attempts to tell believers how to live for God, almost invariably he introduces some type of law.
Are you hearing me this morning? She'll be all right. Mimo's got a hold of her mouth. So many preachers, even your television evangelists, are trying to tell you how to live. They're trying to tell you you can do this, you can do that. But it's all false.
Yeah.
And they'll give you some type of law. Generally made up either by themselves or by others.
Yeah.
Okay. The believer must understand that it is not nearly so much what we do as it is what we believe.
Amen.
In fact, it's not doing at all. It's always believing.
Amen.
Paul said in Romans 4 and 5, he said, but to him who works not, meaning doesn't trust in works for salvation or victory, but believes on him who justifies the ungodly, meaning through Christ and the cross,
yes,
his faith is counted for what? Righteousness. God awards righteousness only on the basis of faith in Christ and his finished work. Amen. You can have faith in your bank account. You can have faith in your home, your cars, or whatever you want, your job. Amen. There is no righteousness in that. But as soon as you place your faith in Jesus Christ and him crucified, amen, come on, God creates righteousness. Come on. I've got righteousness this morning. Why? Because my faith is not in the church, and I love every one of you. My faith is not in you. My faith is in Jesus and him crucified.
Amen. Amen.
So, when we place our faith in there, we'll trust in the Lord in all things. Now go to 1 Timothy. I want you to read. We did Brother Bob did a wonderful teaching on 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, and Titus, and everybody joined in. It was so great. And 1 Timothy 6 and 12. I want to read this one scripture. I want to talk about the sin nature and the struggle just for a few moments here, and I'm going to dismiss you. 1 Timothy 6 and 12 says, fight the what?
The good fight.
The good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called, and have professed a good profession before many witnesses. Strangely enough, church, the struggle with the sin nature applies more than all to believers who are the most consecrated. What do you mean? They love the Lord supremely. Therefore, to fail the Lord is a burden almost too heavy to bear. And yet, not knowing the victory of the cross, they are constantly failing the Lord. Hence the constant struggle. In fact, most of these people are led to believe that this is what the Christian experience is, a daily struggle. No, it's not. No, it's not. Christians are definitely to fight the good fight of faith. Amen?
Amen?
That we read there in 1 Timothy 6 and 12. But that should be the extent of our struggle. If the Christian is in fact struggling with sin, he is trying to fight a battle which he cannot hope to win. The Lord Jesus Christ went to the cross in order that the sin debt may be paid and sin may be defeated. Concerning this, the scripture plainly says in Hebrews chapter 10, verses 12 through 14. Hebrews 10, 12 through 14. But this man, after he was offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God.
Amen.
And from henceforth expecting till his enemies be made his footstool.
Yes.
For by one offering he was perfected forever, them who are sanctified. In other words, our Lord, our God, Jesus Christ, totally and completely defeated sin cross of Calvary. His sacrifice of himself was so perfect, so total, so complete, so absolute, and so final that he will never have to be repeated. Hence, Paul refers to the great covenant as the everlasting covenant.
Amen.
Meaning that because it was and is perfect, it will never have to be repeated or even amended.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So, if I'm struggling with sin, then Satan has duped me into believing something which isn't true.
Amen.
Hello?
Amen.
A Christian might definitely struggle with his faith, but he is never to struggle with sin.
Yep. Exactly.
That have already been addressed totally and completely at Calvary.
Yep.
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
So I don't have to, Brother Vaughn, worry about sin. Why? Because he took care of it.
Amen.
He paid the debt.
Amen.
Come on, church. At Calvary.
Yeah.
But we are so wanting to fight against sin. No, just have faith.
Yeah.
Fight the good fight of faith. Believe that Jesus took care of it, paid it all for you and I at the cross of Calvary. I don't have to worry. Sin's not my problem.
Amen.
Your faith.
Come on.
In that finished work.
That's it.
Leave it there.
That's it.
He defeated sin, church.
Yeah.
I don't have to worry about it.
Thank
you,
Jesus.
Come on. He defeated it. He won. And if we are trying to...
Come on.
The everlasting covenant.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
He is never to struggle with sin. Meaning there is no sin which Jesus did not address in the atonement. So to struggle with sin, listen to me now, is to endeavor to function the devil's terms instead of the terms of the new covenant.
Yes.
Only the latter is victory.
Amen.
Now, Gotta hurry. There's so much today out there in the world, erroneous thinking. Let me help you this morning. Many good Christians, many, as stated, actually think this. Struggle with sin on a daily basis is a lot of Christians' experience. If you are such a Christian, have you ever noticed that you are not winning this fight,
Amen.
But you are rather losing this fight?
Amen.
You are losing simply because you're trying to do something that in the first place you cannot do. And in the second place, Jesus has already done it.
Amen.
Doing it totally and completely at the cross. In other words, he was our substitute.
Yes.
Our identification with him gives us total and complete victory.
Yeah.
I got victory this morning.
Amen.
That, in fact, is what the cross is all about. Paul addressed this by saying in Galatians 2:21, if righteousness came by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. Whether such a believer understands it or not, in his struggle with sin, he is functioning in law.
Amen.
A position which the Lord cannot honor.
Amen.
Are you hearing me? When you function under law, God will not honor that. Jesus said, I didn't come to do away with the law, but to fulfill the law.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Anything. We, as believers, do in trying to live an all-overcoming life outside of simple faith in Christ and the cross is constituted in some way as law.
Yep.
Come on. a position which the Lord cannot honor. In effect, our struggle with sin says that Jesus didn't quite perform the task.
That's it. Amen.
That we had to add our genetic struggle to what he had already done to complete the atonement. I'm struggling with sin. What he did on the cross wasn't enough, so I would help him out.
Yeah.
No, won't happen. Huh? That's where the struggle comes in.
Yep.
We want to be God's little helpers.
Yep.
Jesus, you didn't do it right.
Yeah.
You didn't do it right. You got to do something else. I'm still struggling. Come on, church. Such thinking is a gross insult.
Amen.
To our God.
Amen.
Amen.
Such a position is actually one of spiritual adultery.
Amen.
Which God can and will never honor.
Amen.
You can read that in Romans 7, 1 through 4. I won't go there. If we are fighting and winning, after a while we're going to fight and lose.
Yep.
Such a conclusion is inevitable. As stated, we are to fight only what? The good fight of faith. The battle against sin has already been won.
Amen.
At Calvary's cross. Amen.
Amen.
But there's the temptation. Even Christ was tempted, right?
Yep.
Some will counter by saying that Jesus was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Hebrews 4:15. Yes, Jesus suffered temptation. Let me stop right there. Temptation is not a sin.
Amen.
Amen.
Huh? I said temptation is not a sin.
No.
Well, I was tempted. Did you do it? No, but you didn't sin.
Amen.
Suffer temptation and so will every believer.
Yes, did Jesus.
But what kind of temptations did Jesus suffer? Was Jesus tempted to commit adultery? To steal? To lie? No, he wasn't. His temptation, as is all true temptation, was Satan attempting him to step outside of the revealed will of God.
Amen.
Huh? That's what all true temptation actually is. The devil wants you to step outside of the will of God.
Amen.
Come on, church. So, he tries to get the believer to attempt to function outside the will of God, which is the Word of God, which will then bring on acts of sin. That's what Satan was doing when he tempted Jesus to turn the stones to bread. Satan was trying to get Christ to use his power for himself.
Yep.
Instead for others.
Yes.
Had the Father told Jesus, come on, listen to me now, to turn the stones to bread, that he would have done.
Right.
And should have done. But that's not what the Father told him to do.
Amen.
At least not at this time and place.
Come on.
Whenever the believer gets to the place that he is tempted to commit specific acts of sin, that's a sign that the sin nature in some way is in control.
Amen.
As stated, while there is definitely a struggle attached to this Christian's experience that we're walking, it is without exceptions a struggle of faith. The greatest preacher, anybody know A.N. Trotter? Ever heard of A.N. Trotter?
Amen.
He said this. He said, every attack by Satan against us, no matter the direction it takes, is for but one purpose.
Yes.
And that is to destroy our faith.
Yeah.
And at least seriously weaken our faith.
Yeah.
And guess what? He was right.
Amen.
See, the devil wants to try to take your faith out of the finished work of Christ. And when he does that, then the sin nature will rise up and will go and commit sin. Come on. That old sin nature needs to stay dormant.
Amen.
How does it stay dormant? By keeping your faith in Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Amen. The Bible says we're allowed. I'm allowed, Brother Bob, to get angry. I'm allowed to get upset. The Bible says, sin not. Come on. We're not even going to agree with everything we see, say, or hear, or whatever. But you know what? We get upset about it. I was upset about some of the election. Come on. I wanted to go better than what it did. Huh? I got out. I voted. I did my part. Come on, church. But I'm not going to allow that to let your sin nature rise up and sin. It's not going to change the vote. Huh? Are you hearing me? There's a struggle that goes on. The devil wants you to weaken your faith. And when you weaken your faith, then sin, the old sin nature will rise up in you. Keep your faith in that finished work of Christ.
Yes.
And trust in Him no matter what it looks like. I don't care who's in there for president. I don't care who's in there for the Senate. I don't care who's in the House. My faith is not in them. My faith is in God.
Amen.
God will have the final say.
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
But my job is to pray for them.
Yes.
Yes.
Hey, I don't like that President Biden. Guess what? I don't like him either. But I'm going to pray for him.
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
There's a lot of things Trump did I didn't like. But I prayed for him.
Yes.
Come on, are you hearing me?
Yes.
We can't allow that old sin nature to rise up in us. Yeah, yeah, that person crossed me. I just, No. You heard, most of you heard this on Thursday night. My oldest brother, I don't know how he did it. I would have probably belted a person. But a person was nose to nose with him and, well, I guess, got a big hat and spit right in his face. And my brother said, "I still love you." And hugged him. Most of us were probably gave him a come to Jesus meeting. Why? Because he didn't allow his sin nature. Come on, church. To rise up. And I've learned from that. A lot of people will mistreat you. Will say things about you. What do we want to do first? We want to get right back at them. I'm helping you. Let's take them before the Lord. Let's put them down here on the altar. Amen. Let me close. Yeah, that's the hard part. No, it's not the will of God for us to struggle against sin. That's not more abundant life. But rather, what Paul said in Romans 7:24, "O wretched man that I am." Huh? Don't let the devil, come on, allow you to get your faith out of the cross and onto something else. Because when you do, that old sin nature, huh? We'll rise up. And it will come and be control of your life. Paul said, "Shall we continue in sin? God forbid." that grace may abound? His answer was instant, but God forbid. How shall we live who are dead to sin, live any longer therein? Great book of Romans.
Yes.
May have to go back and teach on that again. See, the devil, he's not going to lay down just because you come to Victory and the Cross Ministry. Oh, they go to Victory and the Cross Ministry, I'll leave them alone now.
Yes.
No, he's going to come harder at you.
Amen.
I'm warning you. Why? Because he don't like what's going on down here on Patterson Street, here or down there. Huh? He don't like it. And he will destroy anything and everything in his way. So if we try to work outside of the perimeter of the cross, then we're opening up to the devil. And he'll allow that sin nature to work in us. But we keep our faith and trust in the cross and allow the Holy Spirit to work.
Amen.
Huh? Guess what? Guess what? Amen. I want to give you a surprise this morning. The Holy Spirit can do more in 5 seconds than we can do in a year.
Amen.
Surprise!
Amen.
Huh? If you didn't know that, you need to know that.
Amen.
Then quit trying to do it ourselves.
Amen.
Because the struggle is there. Amen. Turn it over to the Lord.
Yes. Amen.
Say, Lord, I can't take care of this anymore. He knows it already. I need you to help me. And guess what? Guess what? I got another surprise for you. He'll help you. Huh?
Amen.
Listen to me, folks. God will not answer the prayers of a sinner person unless it is a prayer of repentance.
Amen.
He hears that.
Yep.
So don't be surprised. You heard me say a couple weeks ago here, we had a person one time said, was praying for this and that and asked us to pray about it. When it happened, they go, I don't believe God did that. Hello? You ask, you'll do it. As long as it lines up with the will of God. Amen. His heads are bowed and eyes are closed and Christians are praying. Maybe you're here this morning. Maybe you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus as your Savior. You've truly not accepted Him as your Lord and Savior. I'm not going to embarrass anybody. I'm not here to embarrass anybody, but I want you to slip up your hand and say, Pastor, remember me in prayer. I'm not where I need to be with the Lord. When you pray, just bring me before the Lord. Amen. Is there anyone this morning? Anyone? As we sing this song this morning, I'm going to invite everyone that would come around the altar. Come around the altar and pray this morning. I'll say yes, yes to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord. Yes, come as we sing this morning. Amen, amen, amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. Oh, when your Spirit speaks to me, and with my whole heart I'll agree, and my answer will be yes, Lord, yes. Well, I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. Oh, when your Spirit speaks to me, and with my whole heart I'll agree, and my answer will be yes, Lord, yes. Sing again, I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord.
will trust you and obey. Oh, when your spirit speaks to me, and with my whole heart I'll agree, and my answer will be yes, Lord, yes.
One more time.
Oh, I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. Oh, when your spirit speaks to me, and with my whole heart I'll agree, and my answer will be yes, Lord, yes.
I feel the Holy Spirit is dealing with some hearts this morning. And I want you to bow your heads, each and every one, and close your eyes. And I'm going to say the sinner's prayer to you. And I want you to repeat it. And I want everyone up here on the platform to repeat it, so we're not hearing one, two, three, or four, or five voices, but we're mingling our voices together. These are just words, but if you'll say them and believe them in your heart, and amen, you can walk out of here today a new creature.
Amen.
Amen. All I want you to say is repeat this after me. Dear God in heaven,
I come to you today
asking you to forgive me of all my sins.
I believe Jesus suffered,
died and rose again for all.
I'm accepting Jesus Christ
into my heart to cleanse me
and make me whole.
And now by faith,
I believe I am
saved. Amen.
Amen.
Give the Lord a wonderful hand clap of praise. Amen. You say, Pastor, is it that easy? Yes, it is. The church world makes it hard. You have to go through classes. You have to give money to the church. You have to do this. Amen. The Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Amen?
Amen?
Yes.
And by just saying that, you've said, Lord, I surrender. Amen? When you...
See, a lot of people don't like to raise their hands. When you raise your hands, that's a sign of surrender. When somebody puts a gun to your back and says, raise your hands, what are you going to do? No, I'm not doing it. No, they want you to surrender.
So same way with us. When we raise our hands up to God,
yep,
we say, Lord, I surrender all to you. Amen? Amen. I'll say yes to you, and I'll say yes to your will. Amen? Amen.